عرفت الله ربي أشرق النور بقلبي ملأ البشر حياتي مل أضاء الله دربي يا لسعدي وهنائي يا لفوزي وعلائي لا يطيب العيش إلا في رضا رب السماء.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. قال الله تعالى في القرآن المجيد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. سبحانك لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. اللهم أدعوتني إليك إلى رسولك ما بعد. وقال الله تعالى أيضا قل هو الله أحد الله الصمد لم يلد ولم يولد ولم يكن له كفوا أحد أما بعد. My respected elders and brothers and sisters, first we give praise and thanks to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. لِأَنَّهُ مَحْمُودًا عَلَىٰ كُلِّ حَالٍ وَهُوَ حَمِيدٌ مَجِيدٌ. Under all conditions and circumstances, we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He has given you and I the health and the strength and the ability to be obedient and subservient to Him in this day, and to allow us to gather in this gathering which is known to us as Yawm al-Jum'ah, and which is known to us this day as Sayyidul Ayyam, the chief of all the days of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we send blessings and salutation upon our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his families, his wives and his noble companions. Indeed, as Muslims, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created you and I, and He had made it clear in the Holy Quran. He said that I have not created men nor jinn except that they be obedient and worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Except that they worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah has given us iman without acting to be a Muslim, to be one who obeys Allah and categorize ourselves as Muslim because of iman that Allah has given it to us. But Allah has declared in the Holy Quran and said that يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَيُّهُ بِلِيبُ عَلَيْكُمْ أَنفُسِكُمْ Upon you is the protection of yourself. You are living times. You will be there. A different fitna, a different corruption will be amongst you. You have to live. You will dwell in it. But he said, upon you is the protection of yourself. To safeguard yourself from it, so that it does not fall prey to it. So that you will not find yourself involved into these things. And whenever we find ourselves involved into them, whether in the past, or whether in the future, or the present, then there is only one person accountable, and that's ourselves. And that's ourselves. And we ought to ask forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at all times. Allah, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إِنَّ الْعَبْدَ حَدِيثُ رَقَانِي مَا مُسْلِمْ. He said, إِنَّ الْعَبْدَ بَيْنَ مَخَافَتَيْنِ. He said that really a servant, he will live in two fear of his life, always. He says, بَيْنَ عَجَلٍ قَدْ مَضَى لَا يَظْلِمُ اللَّهُ قَاضِمِ. He says, a man will live in the fear of his life, of his past. Whatever he has done, and he has committed already, he's here now. And whatever he has committed or done in the past, he will live with that fear, how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will judge him concerning it. How Allah will judge him concerning it. Whether Allah will take him to task, or whether Allah will forgive him whatever he has done. And this is a fear that all of us will live with. And he says, وَبَيْنَ أَجَلٍ قَدْ بَقِيَ لَا يَدْرِيمُ اللَّهُ صَنِيعٌ بِهِ. He says at a time, the next fear a man will live with is that fear to come. What will happen tomorrow? What will happen an hour from now with us and ourselves? How Allah will allow him to become? What state he will be in? What condition he will be in? What situation we will be in? That is a fear that we will all live in. Because we are born and we are living. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, one who governs everything and controls everything. And it's upon us to protect this iman that Allah has given to us by very selectively choose our action and the things we say and do. The things we say and do. Because ourself is attached to that. Because Allah says, I've given you iman, but you have to protect it, not me. We saw guidance from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He has given us the choice. Here it is. We have it in our hand, and we have to protect it by the action and the deeds that we will do. By the things that we will do. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have declared that in the Holy Quran. You have to protect it yourself. You have to protect it yourself. And as we are living, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has also, via the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, laid things that you and I should follow and adopt in our life that will make us a better person. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said that there are four signs of an ignorant person. Four signs of a person that is ignorant. He says one is that this person, he allows his nafs and his desires overpowering in the disobedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The nafs, our ego that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given to us, he says he allowed us, this person, it allowed him, and he allowed it, to be in the disobedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He says that when a man finds himself in that state, that that's an ignorant man of the duty towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The other one he says, is that individual, he becomes angry for no reason. He becomes angry for no reason. And he's always angry with things. And you know, he's very, so to say, like very arrogant within himself. He says that this person he become angry without a reason. And he says, thirdly, is that person whom Allah has blessed with wealth and he spend it in a way in the disobedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and doing things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not want. And fourth, he says that that individual, he do not know who his friend is and who his enemy is. He does not know who his friend is and who is his enemy. We are living in society that sometimes we find ourselves with friends and company. Friends and company that will advise us and take us towards the disobedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And sometimes we are unmindful of it. And it will lead us towards, we might not do something, we might not find ourselves involved in something, but it leads us to that. And by leading us to that, we do not know if these people is right for us or they are wrong for us in us to be our company. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that he does not know who his right friend is and who is that one is that him. He's not his, you know, his friend. He does not able to differentiate that. He does not be able to differentiate that. And if we look into our teaching, Islam is complete and it teaches us with all aspects how we could control and we could abstain from this day. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam also said that there are four reasons also that tells you that a person is not ignorant. He is understanding and he is there. He says he does not get angry because he's very patient. Inna Allah ma'as-sabirin, Allah says that means with the patient one. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, he is with the patient one. So it's the opposite. He says that this individual, he's very conscious of Allah. He's sabr and patience upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that he knows Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that controls everything. And he realizes and he understands that La Yadramu Rabbuka Ahada, Allah says that on a day will come upon man when no injustice will be done to him. Today, people do injustice to us. We might find ourselves a man wronged us, he robbed us, he deceived us. But when we stand in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah says La Yadramu Rabbuka Ahada, no injustice will be met you today or no injustice will come upon you. Non-injustice, everything will be dealt with in the right and proper way. No injustice. If a man steal from you, if a man deceive you, then you will get it back on the day of Qiyamah. And you will not get money, that we strive so much for, we'll get the good action and the deeds of that individual. This is how important it is, because on that day when we stand in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, no wealth, no property will benefit us except a man who stands in front of Allah with a heart that is pure, as the Quran has mentioned. Pure and clean in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he said, knowing a person that is upright and is stern, is way of obedience to Allah, is that he is very sober and patient in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Patient and put his trust and reliance upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. His reliance upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And thirdly, he said that this individual does not allow his nafs, his desire, to take him away from the obedience of Allah. He takes a grip of it, he controls it, and he do the things to his best of his ability, what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Al-Kayyisu man dana nafsa. He said, a wise man is that one who controls his nafs, who secures it in the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, does not allow it to be away. Does not allow it to go away in the disobedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So secondly, is that individual who stick a grip onto that. He maintain it, and he guide it, and he turn it into the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Into the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And thirdly, he says that individual, whenever he's spending his wealth that Allah gives him, he spend it in the cause of the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He does not spend it in the disobedience of Allah. He does not utilize it in evil traditions and customs that is here. He spends it in the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to upright and uphold the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at all times. Secure it and do the things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants. And he says fourthly, is that he could differentiate and he know very well who is his right companion, who is his friend that he will keep with and he will incline him towards the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Incline him. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that who's a best friend is that one when you see and you look at him, he only remembers you of Allah. Really? Remember the view of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He says, that's a good friend. He says, that's a good person. That his conscience is there. When you see him and you're in his circle, you're in his gathering, he only remembers you of Allah. Whether by action, his actions, or whether by his words and the things that he do. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has differentiated these categories of people. And whenever we have this, then we'll be good people, and we'll be good people in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We're in an occasion, we're in a season in which we have seen so much of preparation for something that is a festival that is known to us and known to the world. But as Muslims, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us our way of life and is complete in all essence and all aspects of it. From the beginning of Adam alayhi salatu wasalam until the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and his legacy is carried on by the righteous scholars and all who will come to uphold and stand for Islam, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is pure and will continue to be pure, and there is nothing that will, you know, be there to take that true teaching that is there. You'll have segregation, you'll have different, you know, people that will be around. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Al-Yadullah al-Jama'ah, the hand of Allah, the support and the strength will always be upon that group who is always there to establish Islam. And keep it true, and that will be from until Qiyamah. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said he will protect his deen. But leaving all that, that's a whole field by itself. It's a whole study by itself. Then we will get into it. But the point that I'll mention is that in Islam that is there, the Muslims, let's look and to see in our lives these things that is against our teaching, how much of it is present in ourselves. How much of it is present in ourselves? How much is it that we are preparing for such Christmas that will come amongst us? And so much of preparation that we will do to make ourselves safe, to stay happy at this time. You know, we'll always try to be happy in the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But following customs, as we see so much Muslims are involving, is this what Islam taught us? Is this what Islam tells us? As Muslims, as you and I should follow, and you and I should keep our way upon, First of all, let's understand very carefully. As Muslims, we ought not to lie. We don't believe in lies, we don't fabricate lies. And we does not, as Muslims, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and we don't deceive people. If we are doing business, if we are doing transactions, we never unjust another. We don't deceive them. Because if we deceive them, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that whomsoever deceived is not from amongst my ummah. He's not from amongst my people. He's not from amongst my people. And if we look at the whole occasion and festival of this time, it is based on lies. It is based on lies, and it is based on people making more income within themselves and profit from their businesses. And as Muslims, we ought not to believe in that. You know, as I was growing, as a, you know, a little boy growing, when this occasion comes, I used to be happy because I will get gifts. And sometimes, you know, I have to remember also that the night before Christmas, we will go and hang our socks. And when we wake up in the morning, leave alone Fajr, not waking for Fajr, we wake to go and see what Santa has brought for us. And our parents will tell us that he comes and put that there, which in reality, is they will go and buy it, and they will wait until we sleep, and they will put it for us here. And they will put it for us here. So that in itself was a lie. And we were made to believe that because of the season and the festival that is here. And I grew with that until I have become, you know, I have learned and I understand what it is. And sometimes you see them in movie also, in movies. But it's a lie. It is not true. It's not true. And as Muslims, we ought not to believe in lies. And we ought not to get ourselves involved or connected to lies. And I'm sure so much of Muslims, their children will do this for them at this time, at this occasion. And they are growing them on lies. And they are growing them on lies. And that has nothing to do even with Christianity as it's there. It's just because it's the season in which everybody gets richer, or most people who are in business get rich, and they grow with it, despite they will deceive you and I. Despite they will deceive you and I, and because we are not understanding this, we find ourselves traitors. We find ourselves traitors. And they say that Isa alayhi salatu wasalam was born here. Now when we look at the occasion, if you and I were to go into a store on Regent Street or in a big market, and we go inside that store, whether it's the Christmas tree, whether it's the decoration, see how many things you will see that concern Isa alayhi salatu wasalam that is selling in that shop. See, if we go to the market, we will see all the decoration, we'll see the Christmas trees, we'll see the ornaments or whatever, but I'm pretty sure I will not see anything with Easter day, whether a monument of him, whether an idol with him, very few you might see him, because Santa and that occasion have become more popular than the person who they claim that was born on this day. The person that they claim, because that is nowhere in our teaching, and even in the Bible itself says that Isa alayhi salatu wasalam was born in a time when the shepherd will brought their flocks in to their territories in order to prevent them from the cold and the winter season that will set in December. The writer has made mention, he says, that it is not later than the 15th of October. It's not later than the 15th of October, fearing that if their sheep will be out in the desert and the cold winter and the weather is there, they will all die. They will all die. They will all die. And they will, as you have mentioned, he was not born later than the 15th, so it's sometime within there. And it's unknown to us, even as Muslims, we does not know when he was really born. But it was not later than that, it was in the summer, as when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala came to Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam, he came to Maryam and he says that Allah, you know, you will be begotten a child or a son. She said, how can I do that? No man has touched me. woman has touched me. He says, you know, it's the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Kun fayakun, the end will become. So then as the Quran says, she went to the far east. You know, in the far east, when she becomes, to start to become, you know, the child will come, and she will recline on a big palm tree, and the place was hot. But under that beard she was shaded, and then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala provided, you know, fruits, and from the tree, the lily, the branches of Allah Jalaluddin Suyuti, you have made mention in his commentary that Allah the farm to recline in front of her so that she will be able to get things to eat. And at that time, and it was truly in which the heat, the place was hot, but Allah make it cool for her so that the farm tree that she goes to sit underneath and she can work. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is unknown to us. Had it been that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants that to be celebrated, then therefore that he would have been let it known to the people. They would have let it known to them, and they would have understood that. But that's something that Allah does not want. And they have attributed towards that because of many reasons. Many reasons. One writer, you know, he writes about the truth of Christmas and how it come about, and it's based on paganism. It is make mention, he says, that a person by the name of Nimrod, who was the son of Ham, and who was the son of Nuh, alayhi salatu wa salam. Many writers have said he's an atheist. He's an atheist. And he's the one that he was very wicked. He was very wicked. He was the one that have made the law of man to rule. Like for the president, or the king, a man to be the ruler, he's the one who will bring about that in the world, in entirety, Nimrod. And he was so wicked that it make mention, the Christian writer writes it also, he said that this person was so wicked that he ended up marrying his own mom. Marrying his own mom. And he was very arrogant, and he was a king, so he owned a lot of land and a lot of place and properties, etc. But then after when he died, his wife, which was his mother, she propagated a doctrine amongst them, the revival of Nimrod. The coming forth of Nimrod, in which he said that an evergreen tree was there, and that Nimrod on the 25th, which was his birthday, that he revived himself there, and he comes there with presents and gifts to give people. They give people. And they started to worship him. They started to worship him. And this is where it stems from. One, practices that is there, and it's a custom, and this is the 25th of December. This is one that happens here. And this is one that people are involving in. And people are involved. Because this has nothing to do with Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. Isa is pure from this. He's free from this. But because of the occasions, and because of, as I mentioned, so that people will buy more and they will become enjoyable themselves, so that the profit will rise, and they have instigated and they have attributed this towards this here. And even the Christians of the 4th century never knew nothing about this. Never know nothing about it. We start to step in and creep in later. You know, we go and we study further in the encyclopedia and everything. We'll find it, and it's crept in and it's coming about inside of it. So it's based and fabricated on a lie. There's no truth in it. No truth in it. And even here we are like that, but we have become so much that they can't change it. They can't change it. It's already there. Huh? It's all in there. You know, that is why what writer he says that our glory and our downfall is tightly fused together. Tightly fused together. He says the very same thing that bring a handsome revenue to our country. It is the very same thing that destroy the fabric of our society, our youngsters, our children, and our families. Destroys it. So much of revenue that the alcohol, even though that this time here, so much it will bring into the country, revenue. But look how many people it is destroying youngsters. So he says, our glory, when we get more revenue, our country to rise. They developed it. But then our moral status of people become low. So he says, our glory and our downfall, it is tightly fused together so that it brings a handsome revenue to our country, but it destroys the fabric of our society. See how much youngsters will be on the streets. See how much people will be drinking and merrymaking. SubhanAllah. So he says his tongue is used like that. So based on this, that he will become so much stunned, and based on a lie, despite their religion, tell them this is it. But because of that custom, as I mentioned earlier, that he does not allow his nafs, or he allows an ignorant person, he allows his nafs to overpower him. He allows his nafs to take him there. This is what Islam said, no, this is not it. But, you know, I find pleasure in this. I find to be enjoyable in this. So I won't do it. He says that's one sign of an ignorant man. He does not, he allowed that to overpower him, despite he knows that this is what it is. Despite he knows this is what it is. So as Muslims, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala highlighted that to us, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that it's here. There is no base in it. Even a Christian cannot give you a proof that yes, Isa was born on the 12th of May. Isa was born on the 12th of May. It was never like that. Never like that. And that is nowhere in our teaching. So we should not find ourselves involved in these things. That's not for us. We as Muslims, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us through the teachings that is there. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have given us the teachings through Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah has tells us, I have mentioned earlier in my, you know, that I or you is the one who has to protect our iman. You are the one and I am the one that have to safeguard it. Make sure that it's on track. Make sure that we do the thing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from us. Make sure that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, we do that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala pleases. So as my appeal to myself and you all is that this is not the occasion that is baseless. It is based on lies, and you know, we do not involve in ourselves in lies and those things, and so it's against our teachings. It's among the shirk and disobedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us, give us the understanding and the realization that we does not involve ourselves in this time, does not get ourselves involved in the activities. This is totally against our teaching. It is totally against what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from us and what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala teaches us. And don't allow, sometimes we are human, sometimes our nafs and our ego will tell us to do this, tell us to do that. But we have to get a grip of it. Patience and sabr and perseverance in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, Inna Allaha ma'as sabirin. I am with the one who is patient. I am the one. Injustice will not met to us. Injustice will not done to us. Whatever injustice we do to people, we have to be accountable to it. We have to be accountable to it. So we pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give you and I the help and the strength and the ability to be, to understand our duties towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so that we safeguard and protect ourselves in these times and times that will come. All of it, you know, it's there. And we have to always, you know, live a life to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we will not regret it. We will not have to live, you know, in such a way that, well, what I have done is that this, you know, how Allah is going to deal with it. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for forgiveness. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless us. And we take full advantage of our time that we are now, our present time that we are in. Because Allah has given to us, you know, one of the great scholars mentioned, he says that the past, he says that's a history. He said the future is a mystery, but he said the present is a gift that Allah has given to you. So utilize it, make use of it, the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah bless us all in this day of Yom HaZumah, after our dua, and help us to control our nafs and safeguard it from this time and the times to come. Because you know, time as time tomorrow, the time to come will even be worse than tomorrow, than today. As the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that, he said the time to will come upon mankind, the time to come will be worse. Worse than that. I hope and pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give me and you all the guidance and protection. Safeguard ourselves at all times. Protect us from wrongdoings and disobedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.